It started at Virginia Tech University.
They figured out that if they sprayed a solution of this this material, they squeezed the juice out of it and sprayed it on fescue grass in Virginia, they did not have the fescue toxicosis. Wow, that was really interesting. And also the plants grew faster, because at that time they were using it on golf courses to accelerate plant growth. It's a plant steroid if you spray it on grass. And it increases the root size, it increases the plant growth rate, et cetera, et cetera. But they, by accident, they discovered that it will decrease or eliminate this fescue toxicosis, which is a very serious problem in fescue. Fescue toxicosis is caused by an endophyte that appears and grows on fescue at certain times of the year. When this endophyte gets ingested, it causes a very strong vasoconstriction. Again, long stringy hair, hoof problems, tail problems, et cetera, kind of like a selenium toxicity. But it's caused by this fescue endophyte. And so they got to looking at that, and when they started spraying it on the grass and it helped, but then they started feeding the basic material to animals, and sure enough, it would eliminate the negative effects of this endophyte. The only thing it could have been doing was causing a prevention of or reopening those blood vessels. That was their conclusion, but it works. So then they brought that same material out. They brought some cattle that had been fescue grass to Texas Tech from Virginia, and they cooperated, the two universities. But they brought these animals out from Virginia to Texas Tech University, put them in the feedlot and fed them out, and they found some really interesting things. First of all, the animals traveled better. They had less health problems. Secondly, these animals had a much better carcass quality. The quality grade on those animals was much better at the end of the feeding period. They also found that when they looked at E. coli shedding, the E. coli shedding was much less in animals that had been fed or were on the Ascophyllum nodosum when they got out here. They also learned out there that it increased storage of vitamin E in the liver. And over the years, and this is kind of getting kind of old now, but they have 6 USDA patents on this Ascophyllum nodosum for the things we're talking about. And it's one of the few ingredients that carries a USDA patent. And that takes a lot of research, but it's really, and I've been working with this product for about 25 years, the first time I fed it to animals, and I've used it in every program I have ever since. Then they wanted to look at the heat tolerance, because they seemed to feel that the animals stayed cooler because they didn't go to the shade as often when they were fed this. So the University of Missouri has some heat chambers where they literally put animals in a heat chamber and they can raise the temperature until they get the body temperature rise that they want. And to make a long story short, when they did that, if they were feeding these animals the Ascophyllum nodosum, the body temperature would not go up as high. It would stay at a lower point, which is a huge benefit. If you can hold the body temperature on an extremely hot day, whether your horses or your cows or any of them, at about a half to 1 degree lower than it would raise, that's a huge thing to those animals. And so we've kind of used that in our programs, especially in these heavy-hauled horses in the summertime, horses that are used very heavy on the ranch in the summertime. People are all telling me that their horses will work harder and longer in hot weather than they've ever seen before. They don't get tired. They'll sweat profusely because it increases that body water. But they don't get high-headed. They don't get that hot, belligerent attitude early in the day when it's extremely hot. Finding the same thing in working dogs. I have people telling me how on a total canine, that their working dogs will work way harder in hot weather. They don't get tired. They don't have to get them in a creek or in a water tank as often to let them cool down. So we're very comfortable that that effect is there. Then the University of Alabama also did a body temperature study on black cows in the summertime in southern Alabama. It's a good place to do that, isn't it? Humid, hot, and they found that it was hold their body temperature at least half to three quarters of a degree lower than cattle or cows without it. They also found that they had a reduced hornfly population by 50%. And other places have done some of that too, and not sure why, but the hornfly population is less when you feed this to animals out on grass in the summertime. North Dakota State University did in vitro trials with Ascophyllum nodosum on bacterial growth. They didn't qualify or quantify the bacteria themselves, but they did measure that fiber digestibility was increased quite dramatically. I believe that's one of the factors when you feed total equine to horses, they'll eat 15 to 30% less hay. If you put it in bucking bulls, cows, growing calves, whatever, in ruminants, goats, lambs, they'll eat at least a third less hay. It has to be an enhancement of microbial activity. The only reason they would eat less hay because they're getting much more out of it, because the animals are doing great. It's just that they're eating less feed. And it's that even then, that's at a lower feeding rate than most other products on the market, which we'll talk about in total equine and total bull. And then the University of Alberta, they have a research unit at Lethbridge, and we did some research up there. I worked with this company back, a number of years ago now, where they fed some lambs, and they started them with like 14 days at one level of total of Ascophyllum nodosum, or they would pulse dose them for 7 days with a different level, and they did some various things. It didn't matter whether they gave them an extremely high level for 7 days or a smaller level for 14 days. The shedding of E. coli would start to go down after that treatment. It would stay the same in the control animals, but it started going down. And by the time those lambs were ready to go to harvest, the shedding of E. coli was almost none. It continued all through the feeding period to go on down, even though they weren't feeding the product through the entire feeding period. This is very, very interesting product, and that's why I use it in all my animal products.